Hey, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome. I'm Ken Foster, Executive Director here at YBCA. I want to welcome you to our conversation this afternoon on serving 1 billion more, cultural commons, environmentalism. Just for those of you that don't know, this is a series of 6 conversations that we're doing around an art project that we have opening in July called Bay Area Now, which is a triennial exhibition of visual arts, performing arts, film, and video that we do every 3 years, triennial. Leading up to that, we've had this series of 6 conversations about topics that we feel are, and experts in those areas who are sort of on the cutting edge of that, who are Bay Area based and are on the cutting edge of thinking in these different places. And we're trying to bring that intersection intersect those with art and artists. So the people in the center of the room are some of the artists who are in the exhibition and the project that opens in July. And so what we'll do, and you'll see as this unfolds throughout the day, is that we're going to engage our speaker, Adam Werbach, primarily with the artists initially, and then ultimately open it up to the larger audience. So when you see that happening, that's what we're doing and why we're doing it. Let me introduce you to Adam Werbach, who is the Chief Sustainability Officer for Saatchi & Saatchi. Is regarded as one of the world's leading authorities on creating sustainable businesses, is the author of the book Strategy for Sustainability, I'm struggling over that word. He guides their sustainability work from China to South Africa to Brazil, advising companies like Walmart, Procter & Gamble, General Mills, and AT&T. He worked with Walmart to engage the company's 2 million associates in its sustainability effort, creating the Personal Sustainability Project. In 1996, so now you can do this math, because in 1996 at age 23, so you can figure out how old he is now, Werbach was elected the youngest ever president of the Sierra Club, the oldest and largest environmental organization in the United States. But behind all of that verbiage, which we all recognize as a conventional bio that many of us have, is a really truly creative, innovative thinker who has done extraordinary work with organizations like the Sierra Club, but also organizations like Walmart, to really help us rethink the whole concept of environmentalism and what it means and how we're connecting to that within our world. So we're really, not only are we excited to have Adam here today, but we're excited to have him in dialogue with artists so that we begin to open up some questions and ideas about how art connects into this idea as well. So, Adam.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks so much. All right, I am totally thrilled to be with you and in dialogue, so please cut me off, jump in, throw things in right away so we can have this conversation together. Behind all those things that Ken read about me is someone who is basically, I view my work as a failure over a long period of time. I have a thirst to re-examine everything I've done, and I'm constantly in the place to do that. So while 10 years ago, I would have told you that I'm sort of an expert, today I'll tell you that I don't really know very much, and I keep on finding that I know even less, particularly in the space of environmental protection, ecological protection. What I want to talk about for the next half hour or so, before we get into sort of the deeper part of participation, is essentially how the ecological movement is conceived of right now. Some of the myths behind it, how it's thought of, and challenge some of those. And then look at how sustainability, which is, I differ from environmentalism, is working to respond to some of the things that are happening in society right now. Somewhere it's failing, somewhere it's succeeding. And through it all, I would just invite you to think about humanity as the central point of it. So while some people in the environmental movement really see nature first, I view humans as core to nature, and actually the desire or reason to protect nature is also to protect humanity itself. So I invite you to put yourself in a humanist standpoint as we talk through this. So, get started, a great feat of modern humanity. Anyone recognize car? Which is it? DeLorean, yes, which was fantastic. And it is also a time machine, right? A time machine. So we will start off with a little bit of a thought exercise. Because when we think about natural resources, humanity and culture, we're talking about generations and time, thousands of years. So I'm going to grant you a DeLorean time machine, but it's only a single-use time machine. You can go any place, any time. So take a moment and think about where and when you would go. Take a minute. Any place, any time. Got it? Okay, raise your hand if you would go to the past. Okay, wow. Raise your hand if you would go to the future. Okay. Raise your hand if you'd go to like a place which you would consider home, a place that you know well. And raise your hand if you'd go somewhere not home. Interesting. I wish we could talk to everyone, but maybe we just quickly go around with the artists and just quickly, like, where and when you would go. Ken, why don't you start with you here?
I would go to Bali about 100 years ago.
Bali 100 years ago. Why?
I visited there last year, and I was really taken with the world, the spiritual world there, and wanted to go 100 years ago, which is a guesstimate, because before it became like the hip, trendy place for everybody to go.
Yeah, so see what it was like before. It had sort of changed.
Yeah.
And please introduce your name, too. So.
Brian Boyce. I was thinking ancient Greece.
Ancient Greece.
An interesting spot to, if you're going to end up,
one place.
Park it there for a while. There's a lot going on there.
A lot going on. Cradle of civilization at the time.
I'm Johnny Simons. I'm not sure why I chose this, but I thought of Mexico at the time of the Aztecs.
Can people hear? Okay, I won't repeat.
Oh, here, we can pass the mic around.
Oh,
thank
perfect.
You.
Thank you.
Great.
Yeah, answered mine. Mexico at the time of the Aztecs, amazing, right? No, you'd be an Aztec, I would assume. That would be hard if you weren't,
yeah.
I think.
Do I get that part of the time machine?
Yeah, yeah, I would hope, yeah. It would just be a challenge if you weren't, I think.
I would stay here.
Stay here?
But I'd be here in sometime in the 18th century.
Oh,
it was
right here.
Very different.
What would you see if you, like, right here? What would you see?
I'd like to see what it was like before any kind of ecological change. I think that would be fascinating to view California.
Grizzly bears in San Francisco, right? You know, the
no
sunset,
trees.
The beach, no trees. Yeah, fascinating.
I would.
And tell me your name, sorry.
Sean.
Sean, okay, thanks.
Richard Walker. I would actually just go, I think, to North Wales, somewhere around 82. 1982, where I used to go on holiday with my parents, and it was where I first started to think about the landscape in certain ways, so that's where I would go.
It just had
quite
deep
unadventurous in a way.
Well, it's, in fact, it was a sort of really deep emotional pull. Do you have fond memories of that time in your life? Yeah, that's neat.
I'm Chris, and I couldn't think of an exact place. I thought of like dozens, but none of them are here, and none of them are in the future. Or now. I don't know. There's just a lot of cool things that I'd like to see.
So dinosaurs. You don't know where. You would just go somewhere. Kind of hit the random
button.
Yeah,
seriously. Go before people. I don't know.
Go before people.
Yeah.
Interesting.
I'm Suzanne. I thought of the past, and I thought that in terms of being a woman in the past, it would be more interesting to go in the future with humanity gone well. So thoughtful development.
You're going to the future.
Humanity.
Yeah. You're wondering for a few future...
And nowhere specific, because everything would be so much more.
But do you think for women in particular, it'd be better in the future than in the past?
Hopefully.
Yeah, hopefully.
Hi, I'm Robert. I was thinking early 1600s, Rome, Italy, particularly because I've always kind of been interested in painting in that time period, and also I'm just very interested in Roman history. I lived there for a while, and just, socially, just kind of an interesting time, and so I was kind of curious about what it was like then.
Yeah, amazing, 1600s.
I'm Sam, and I choose Dubai in like 60 years, probably.
Dubai in 60 years. Do you think it'll exist?
What?
Will it exist in 60 years?
Mm-hmm, okay. Definitely. I expect weird things. That's why I want to do that.
Expect weird things.
My name's Kirby, and I want to go to Argentina in like 3 months. That'd be awesome.
You might be able to get that. That's great.
I'm Chris. I actually had the very same idea of coming to California in about 1810.
1810. What was happening in 1810?
Nothing, or at least
right. Less.
Less. Yeah. I just for the environment. But since that was already taken, I also thought that it would be great to go to New York in the late 40s, early 50s, mostly for the music.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Hi, my name is Danielle. I went farther back. I actually wanted to meet Gilgamesh. It's one of our earliest, actually our earliest written epic that also talks to some degree about like the social contract. It's like one of the first formalized social contracts that we have, and I'm curious to see how much the reality and the story have to do with each other.
The Epic of Gilgamesh, actually the first story of climate change, right, too.
Yes.
It was a culture that had amazing droughts, and the whole culture had been changed because of it, and that was
10,000 BC.
10,000 BC,
yep.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I was thinking maybe the East Coast at the time of the American Revolution.
Huh, where? In like Boston?
Philadelphia.
Lexington, Philadelphia, yeah.
Ernesto, and I thought Buenos Aires 1920s, 1930s.
Why?
That's what I thought. There was an interesting culture was seeping in from Europe into South America at that time. So there was a lot of art and art, new things happening down there. So I would love to live there then.
That's fascinating.
Jesse, I was thinking somewhere in the Midwest around like the late 70s.
Why? Why? I say that positively.
I think I like really romanticized the movie Dazed and Confused.
Yeah, I couldn't settle, but I'm Laura. But the one thing I did settle on was I'd like to see dinosaurs. So.
Oh yeah.
That would be cool.
Maybe you'd want to be a dinosaur yourself.
Yeah, that'd be nice.
Running.
A big one.
Which kind?
I don't know. One that could fly.
So probably your own.
Yeah. I don't know. I have to think about it.
Yeah.
David. Unfortunately, I have two time periods. I've been watching a lot of Rockford Files, so the late 70s, mid 70s has been really interesting to me to be in, and also like ancient Egypt. I want to see people pushing and carrying stones and building pyramids. I want to see that act.
Amazing.
It's just too...
The engineering, yeah.
It's just... And there's no record.
Have you been
it.
To Egypt?
No.
Interesting.
I'm hoping to get there. I mean, you're showing us some pictures.
Yeah, we'll take you there.
I'm Kara, and I was thinking it'd be interesting to go to France when they were painting on the caves.
Oh,
but I
yeah.
want to be invisible.
Okay.
And...
That's another car.
For two reasons. One, because I'm female. And second, because I'm probably 20 years older than the time that people died during that age.
Oh, yeah.
So I'd probably scare them as well. So.
Fantastic. Oh, thank you. Interesting, right? Interesting. Like, what did you notice about commonalities between you and this, in this list that came out?
Pre, you know, California before it was all this stuff that it is, all this a desire for a less complicated place.
Yeah, I heard that. I heard that. What else?
And then certainty, too, because most of the people want to go to the past in places that they know something about. I mean, very few people want to jump ahead and hope that the, you know, human condition would improve. You know, it can also get worse. So, you never know.
Yeah. Anything else? I was struck how there were some different folks who wanted to go, you know, to Wales, to Buenos Aires, to New York, to see these different times of artistic beauty and expression, to kind of recapture that. I definitely was struck by the fact of how many people wanted to go to the past. I kind of imagine that if we had asked, you know, if YBCA was here 50 years ago, but if we had asked that question 50 years ago, many more people would have thought about the future. Would have imagined this time, you know, where would think 60, 70 years ago. Imagine when, you know, someone would walk on the moon, when we'd have a small nuclear reactor in our dining rooms that would make food instantly, when energy would be too cheap to meter. But there was a lot more future thought and future fantasy 50 or 60 years ago in our culture than there is now. And the reason I kind of am fascinated by our views of future and past, and I would tend to go to the past too, because it's so much things we could learn, the certainty of that, is because when you talk about ecology, you are actually talking about the story of connections. The definition of ecology comes from ecos, protecting your home, which is a Greek word, Latin root. And you know, the sort of the most famous statement of ecology was by John Muir, who is one of the founders of the Sierra Club, who said, when you pick anything up by itself, you find it hitched to everything else in the universe. We're all connected. Everything is connected, regardless of how we talk about it. And one of the reasons I'm kind of critical of particularly 80s and 90s environmentalism was that it really became protecting nature, which of course is one thing, but it's connected to us as well. So when I talked about the definitions, we might define environmentalism as is the fight to protect nature. Being an environmentalist, I'm there to protect nature. The broader study of ecology is humans in nature. And then when we talk about sustainability, we're probably talking in different contexts. In business, it's really about how do you make a business run for the long term in a profitable way. And I'll talk a bit about that. In terms of human culture, the question is, how do you make human culture survive in the context of limited natural resources? How do humans and nature work together? And that's the core piece that we're going to be pushing on, sort of asking about that culture and how our art and how our expression fits within forming that culture. So with that, we'll jump in. This is an axolotl. It's a Mexican salamander. It's absolutely incredible. There are only a few hundred of these left in the wild, although this one is actually in an aquarium. And it's being studied by biologists because it has these amazing features, sort of like a lizard. If you chop off its tail, it grows back. But if you chop off its arm, the arm grows back. And that's pretty unique. But the extremely unique thing about this thing is that if its heart is injured, its heart grows back. So they're looking at that as a sort of a key to heart regeneration therapy. There's about, again, a few hundred of these left. They're threatened by development. And you know, it begins to be a tale about extinction that we understand. This is a picture of a jaguar. Actually, we know the name of this jaguar, Macho B, because Macho B was the last wild jaguar in the United States. And I say was because 2 years ago, basically now, 2 years ago this in March, Macho B was killed by an effort to protect him, bungled by the Department of Fish and Game in the state of Arizona. The reason I just sort of point to these animals, and I've sort of criticized some bit of environmentalism and kind of a nature-first argument, those, when lost, are an incredible loss for humanity and for the planet. And the rate of extinction is speeding up right now. How do we conceive of that, though? This is probably, in my mind, the most important book in evolutionary biology since The Origin of the Species by Darwin. It's around the concept of punctuated equilibrium, which basically says that as things evolved, there are two models. One is a gradual model, which is to the left here, where it says that things are evolving and things branch off. And the other is what they call punctuated equilibrium, where everything's going the same, and all of a sudden, boom, something changes. All of a sudden, boom, wow, opposable thumbs, cool, different. And that's a very different view from the sort of model where everything sort of creeps along and changes slightly. And what I'll suggest to you in the way of conceiving this conversation is that we're in a moment of punctuated equilibrium, that punctuated is actually the kind of mental model for how things are changing right now. And particularly in an ecological sense, things are changing so radically that the ways that the models that we've had to monitor this, to work as humanity together, protect things, whether it be like a Clean Air Act or an Endangered Species Act or protecting some small local pollutant, those are all gone. And we're now trying to re-knit how we protect ourselves from this massive threat of climate change. It's so much bigger and so different than anything that we know. It's breaking the whole system that creates a habitable Earth for humans. So when broken, there's no simple law you can pass. And they tried to pass a cap and trade bill, which totally failed, and that, even that was not a solution. We have to do something different. In this era, we need to build towards surviving in a punk eek world. Now for companies, we see this change really affecting them. If you look at one side being business growth and one side being societal change, the incumbent, so the business like, you know, I mentioned some of the big consumer products companies, but any big company doesn't thrive in social change right now because they basically exist because, you know, you always bought this thing and you're going to the store, you buy the same thing. But if you're changing, your needs are changing, then that threatens their market. Similarly, if you're an innovator, you need things to change to be able to survive, right? You actually need change because you're gonna take advantage of that. Now, what that looks like for some industries is kind of scary. This is a picture of how the record industry is done, which is not well. Not giving you any surprises here. But between, you sort of look at that year around 2001, you saw the peak of record company sales, close to $15 billion. And you see it's a mix between, you know, pretty much 8-tracks were dead by then, no surprise, tapes dying, and CDs, or this boom of CDs. Remember we were paying like $18.99, $16.99? How stupid were we, right? And then it just sort of fell off a cliff. Look at that. I mean, of course, this is Napster, 2000. When was Napster started? Probably around that time, 2005, right around that time. We watched the whole change in the format of music happen to the industry. Again, this is sort of that societal change hitting it. Now, they responded, Ken and I were talking, of course, they responded in all the worst ways, right? They started putting, you know, walls around their businesses. They started suing college students. They did everything wrong to react to change. And the challenge that I want us to think about is, how do we react to change? How, when punk eek hits us, when massive, systemic, radical change hits the things that matter to us, how do we respond? With TV dinners. So to do that, let's talk about the way that people have thought about innovation in the past. And the TV dinner is an extraordinary fable, myth, about the way that American ingenuity has worked in the past. So the TV dinner was invented in about 1954 by a guy named Jerry Thomas, who worked for the Swanson's company. Now, Swanson's had ordered too much turkey for Thanksgiving, like 5,000 tons too much turkey. That's a lot. They put it on refrigerated rail cars and started spinning it around the country. And they were a restaurant supply company at the time, and trying to figure out, you know, what do we do with the turkey? They had these board meetings. I don't know. What do we do with the turkey? I don't know. Put it on the trains. Figure it out. Maybe we start a new holiday. We call it Turkey Day. Like, didn't work. So they're in January already, and they haven't figured this out. Rotting turkey. I mean, it's old turkey. But, frozen, but still dead turkey. Jerry Thomas, who had been in the military, he'd eaten those off mess trays. He had actually been studying the new freezing technology by Clarence Birdseye. And the big technology he saw was television. Right? Television was this new thing and just coming into being. He talks about how he was in Iowa and he'd walk down the main street and people would be five deep at the store watching a TV on the outside. He saw this dislocation, this change, this punctuated equilibrium moment right then. And he put all these things together to create the TV dinner. The first year they released the TV dinner, they sold 10 million units, 10 million of them, which is, I mean, extraordinary. 10 million TV dinners. Within 5 years, they were selling $300 million a year. So this is the old story of innovation. But what caused it was three things. A change in society, which was actually the fact that after World War II, about 8 million women had re-entered the workforce and stayed there, and they needed help making meals. They were still responsible for that. They were making meals. The technology changed, this television, this freezing technology, and the resource changed. There was free turkey. Free turkey, you've got to do something with it. And that, in the 20th century, is sort of the model of how innovation happened. We had free resources. We had this change in technology and change in society, and people took advantage of that to make innovations. The challenge is they kind of blew it. This is an innovation in water. Water from Fiji. Now, there may be a dumber idea out there. I have not yet found it, although I'll try to show you a couple others. you know, the idea that we have enough energy and water to be able to ship it across the planet to be able to drink it is just sort of rubbing the nose of the planet on. But absolutely outrageous. This is dead brand walking. This is the type of company that, you know, they sell many hundred millions of dollars of Fiji water, but they won't be around. The planet can't sustain that. Here's another idea from a local company, the plastic wrap banana. Now, I don't know if any of you have noticed this, but there already is a wrapper on a banana. The audacity of this one is that they did this for ecological reasons. Because what happened was, and here's a behavioral cue, I think we're going to be talking about culture and behavior, so recall this. What they were saying is that at mini marts, like 7-Elevens, people will not buy a banana if it has any brown on it. So they have to be thrown away, which is obviously bad. If you spend all this time growing the perfect banana in Central America, shipping it all the way here, it sits on the shelf for one day too long, looks brown, you can eat a banana with brown spots, not going to kill you, tastes great, even better for baking. So they would actually have to be throwing all these out. And this bag would extend it on a shelf for 5 more days. So it would save it. So while it's sort of annoying to have a little plastic bag here, from their perspective, it, from a life cycle standpoint, was better for the banana. Now, this is a really bad cultural intervention, in my experience. This sends all the wrong signals. And there were probably some other ways to have solved the problem of people not liking brown bananas. Like, what's another way they could have done it? Educate people. Yeah, yeah. Brown is fine. A little bit of brown's fine. Advertising, yeah, marketing, getting the word out. But it's an example of the type of behavior that we obviously spend money and resources at to change quite ineffectively. And you also think that sort of the ramifications of just wrapping one more thing one more way sends a signal. That's not necessarily good. Well, here's another one. There's now a 6-bladed razor, because 5 blades wasn't enough. Let's go to 6, even better. I don't even know how you lift it, right? It's like 6 blades. It's kind of outrageous. But this is 20th century, not 21st century. This is the innovation of incremental innovation, taking one thing and just making it a little bit better, not even a little bit better, just, you know, a way to stand. It's just a marketing ploy, right? I can't, anyway. Not gonna. Oh, there's shaving cream inside the handle, too. Sorry, that makes it great. The point of these examples is that this is how our innovation minds have been exercised over the last few decades. That is probably not the way to respond to challenging times. The good news is that there are some larger and broader patterns that are happening in society that will be the leads to us, the hints that will drive us towards a better model of innovation with a planet with limited resources. I mean, you know, this story, of course. WikiLeaks releases cables that actually share that the Tunisian president, Ben Ali's son-in-law, had a tiger that ate 6 chickens a day, and many people in Tunisia have no capacity to buy 6 chickens, so they were kind of upset about that, threw him out, which, of course, led to Mubarak being thrown out, and now he's up. They're reviewing whether they're going to execute him, and Gaddafi is not so happy anymore. So the point being that information spreading out and transparency is an incredibly effective way of making change and will be core to responding to a punctuated equilibrium world. Of course, people are kind of slow to embrace that. The largest meat recall, these are cows, I don't know if that wasn't clear. The largest meat recall in US history happened by a company named Hallmark Westland. And it happened because a Humane Society activist got a job at one of the slaughterhouses and brought his cell phone in and filmed the cows being beaten and looked like sick cows being pushed into slaughter. He took those films back, uploaded them on YouTube, and they went all over the place. And there was this outcry to recall this meat, which was largely school meat sent into school lunches. The company almost went out of business. It was something like $150 million recall. And the company almost went out of business in the process. And right around that time, I was on a plane and I was sitting next to a guy who owned slaughterhouses. Always talk to people next to you in airplanes. You'll find the strangest people. He owned slaughterhouses. I was like, oh, this is really interesting. How did you respond to this punk eek moment? You know, this, you know, this is this big threat to you and your slaughterhouses. And he said, well, as an industry, we've decided to change. I said, well, what's the change? He goes, we have a new policy. What's your policy? We have banned cell phones from all of our slaughterhouses. It's like, you know, problem, no problem, problem, no problem. Now, that is the wrong response to this sort of transparency all the way through coming. You know, you can make fun of Twitter. You know, you can mock it. You can attack it. You can fear it, or you can figure out ways to embrace it and understand that this is a trend that is extraordinarily powerful that's coming. And in my work with a lot of companies, this is something that scares them. They have lawyers who exist to make the organization. I'm saying that's actually what you need to welcome. So that's the first trend I want you to think about, this transparency in all its forms. The second one is engagement. Ken mentioned the work that I had done with Walmart, and I'll just give you a couple examples. You know, when we started working with Walmart, the mental model for most folks, you know, many of the workers are people who are making 12, 13 bucks an hour, you know, not particularly interested in issues like sustainability. We actually found it completely different. They were extraordinarily interested in it. And an example would be one associate who's in West Virginia who decided to set his own personal sustainability project of saving energy in his house. So he put in insulation, he changed his heater out, and he lowered his energy bill by about $120 a month, which is very significant for him and his family. He came to work one day and he noticed that the Coke machine in the break room, not this one, but one like it, had a light on it, and he sort of figured that if he could pop out that plastic piece, he could unscrew the light bulb, because he knew that it was a Coke machine, he knew it was on, he didn't need to have a light on it as well. He told his other friends at other Walmarts in the area, and they all did the same thing, because they thought it was a way they could save money, and actually the local stores have to pay for their own energy, so it was a way for them to get their bonus too, because they could lower the operating expenses of the store. The CFO heard about it, because some of the local distributors were upset that the employees were breaking the machines. And the CFO said, this is great. Yeah, everyone should do this. And so every store started breaking their machines and taking that out. That effort saved Walmart about $1 million a year in energy costs. And that's just because it's a huge, obviously ginormous company. But the idea that someone took something from their own personal behavior and translated it into their corporate behavior is a really exciting hint about the way that people can break down these walls between their work life and personal life and try to achieve something according to that. I'm happy to, you can't sort of talk about Walmart without having a larger political conversation, which I'm happy to have with you individually if you're interested. And there's no doubt that Walmart has a huge, huge, huge way to go. But the point I want to focus on is that individual changes, when you plug someone in, you open their eyes, you invite them to do something, they'll invent a lot from the bottom without ever having to for the top to sort of tell them what to do. It's kind of a hint that, to me, is really exciting. This is Sumatra. And there used to be a mountain there. It became a lake because it exploded about 70,000 years ago. And at the time, it released something like 800,000 square kilometers of ash into the atmosphere and created a little ice age, an ice age. And it wiped down the human population from its size at that time to something like a few thousand family units on the entire planet. This was kind of the choke point in evolution of humanity at that moment. And we can all trace ourselves back to then. And the thing that's sort of incredible to me is that most of human culture, as we understand, came from that small group of people, right? It spread to everything we know from that particular moment. And what I want to challenge us to think about as we go into the next part of this, we're just about on time, is what type of cultural interventions we can have to help humans begin to relate with each other in this period of limited ecological resources. The model in the past has been legal or financial incentives, ways that we can basically push people or compel people to change because we have to, right? I don't think anyone here is going to argue whether climate change is happening. It's happening. How do we change around it? And what I'll suggest to you, and why I'm here today, is that it's probably not going to be this legislative framework that compels humanity to do it. It will be something communal, it'll be something artistic, and it will be work in the cultural realm as opposed to work in the political or legal realm. So what I'm gonna invite us to think about after kind of a brief time of some questions with Ken is how we actually begin to make those interventions. With that, thank you. We'll go on to the next part.
Yep.
Ken?
Yep. Okay, so we're gonna have a little conversation here, and I'll invite you to ask questions as we go along here, and we'll do this for about 20 or 30 minutes, and then we'll have a break and come back and do some small group conversation. I guess the first thing I'm kind of curious about is, you've laid out some interesting ideas and theses here, and I'm completely intrigued by this punk eek. To what degree is that, I mean, are you in a small group of people that get this or are thinking this way, or do you find that that's, that kind of thinking is becoming more pervasive? What's your sense of like the, I'm gonna say in terms of the environmental movement, but I know that's a little problematic, so let me just sort of just ask it in general.
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, if you talk to normal folks, I mean, people who aren't organizationally or movement affiliated, they all believe this, right? I mean, it's hard not to find someone who doesn't believe this is the displacement moment, that everything is changing, that it's really scary right now, that the job their dad had is not the job that they'll have, that they won't have one career, that they won't work in the same way that they used to. They're worried about education for their kids. They have lots and lots of anxiety. And, you know, this is the study. There's a great book by Greg Easterbrook called the Progress Paradox, which says, when you look at all these standards of progress, right, which is like, do you have a home, do you have a car, can you have a way to transport yourself, are your kids educated, you know, can you vote, you know, all these sorts of things, do you worry about suffering from disease, life expectancy, et cetera, humans are incredibly better off than they have ever been.
Right.
Extraordinary right. story. Yet we all worry.
Right.
We're less happy right now,
right.
largely because, I think, of accepting this. Now, that this is this moment of punk geek. Now, the question of the environmental movement, I think, you know, frankly, and this is, you know, I'm a lifetime member of the Sierra Club, I was a board member of Greenpeace a long time, I'm still absolutely strongly supportive of these organizations. They are, you know, kind of by necessity stuck into a framework where they have to work on legal changes, policy changes, and community organizing changes that match that. They don't really work at that base level of thinking about the needs of those folks who are so worried right now.
Right.
And that's I think, the challenge.
That's interesting. Is that, when you asked us about what we each, you know, where we each wanted to be, it was interesting you commented about 50 years ago, if you asked that question, people would imagine a future moment. Now is sort of looking to the past. Is that a similar kind of response to this, that you feel like, oh, I'm kind of longing for a easier, simpler time?
My friend Ted says, and this is a little harsh, he says that nostalgia is a blank check for the untrained mind. You know, he basically said that you can apply anything onto your nostalgic view of what the past was like, but of
right.
course, like, you know, we were talking about the status of women, of course it was generally speaking worse in the past, very, you know, over so there are a lot of things that were worse then, but we romanticize them in our minds in the past. And it is quite, I mean, you know, by nature, artists are mavericks and are less connected in a literal way to the kind of cultural tropes that
right.
everyone else holds.
Right? Right.
It's just that artists are allowed or invited to actually separate and to imagine.
Right.
So it's interesting. I mean, it's an interesting question about whether artists 50 years ago would have said the same thing or whether it's not. I mean, it doesn't, I mean, there's no right or wrong answer, right?
Right, sure.
But I think it does express for ourselves where we see the future right now and how kind of bright and optimistic we are about how that future will look.
Yeah. I'm kind of, this is a little bit different, but I'm just curious as to what drives you to work with Walmart and Procter & Gamble and places like that. Why would you make that choice?
Well, from what I was saying at the beginning, I'm pretty dissatisfied with the effect of my work. You know, I've been a environmental activist since I was 13 or something, or even younger. It just, and you know, I can tell you when I, you know, great victories that I thought we had, you know, protecting the California Desert Protection Act is, from my mind, just an amazing crowning achievement.
The California
Desert Protection Act. So if you go to Death Valley National Park, East Mojave National Monument, Joshua Tree National Park, this was all passed in 1994 by a piece of legislation that we lobbied incredibly hard for and passed in a very conventional way. And, you know, I'm so, you know, go there, love it, explore that, you know, there's nothing greater than desert in my mind. That's the kind of ecology I love. Mm-hmm. But it's all at risk from climate change.
Right.
You know, especially places, marginal places like that are particularly challenged by them. So to say that I've been an effective professional over my career would be a joke, a laughing joke. And so I look back at the work that I was doing at the Sierra Club as great, but inadequate. And you know, and not saying that other people's isn't great, but mine.
Right.
So
right.
I started working with companies because I saw this great opportunity, this really powerful mechanism that all of a sudden, you know, instead of attacking green, was beginning to say, well, maybe we could use this somehow. So I see it as a really important lever. But I, you know, even that, after, you know, I've been doing that for 5 or 6 years, and I have as many criticisms of myself for that as well, because that's not getting there either.
Right.
I mean, frankly, I'm more excited about the broader cultural interventions that will push individuals to make behavior changes that will guide what these companies sell and what these environmental organizations support.
Right.
But
right.
That's our challenge. But there's no, I mean, this is as close as we get to a think tank about that.
A think tank
it
about
doesn't, cultural It doesn't really, like, those sort of interventions don't, no one talks about that.
Yeah, yeah, that's a good point. So you mentioned that transparency and engagement are the two pieces of the sort of punk eek phenomenon that you think are signs of the punk eek, or generated it, or responses to, or sort of all of the above?
I think those are hints to how we can respond to crisis moments like this in some way that's productive. That, as you know, we're not blind observers to this. We are participants in this drama. And that those dual trends, that particularly that view that transparency is going to change the way that we can tell that things are happening,
right,
which is scary, frightening, and wonderful,
right.
That's a piece of it. And the second is this new way of personal engagement, that you know that people are engaged in a very different way with sources of power, with the companies they work for, with the organizations they affiliate with. Those are two tools that I think we can use to respond, to build cultural responses to right.
To those moments, yeah. Let me ask if you guys had questions that you wanted to ask Adam, thoughts that came up in his presentation. Yeah.
Checking, check. Thank you. This is so fascinating. Thank you. So Bruce Sterling, the author, had this great list that's somewhat dormant now called the Viridian List, which he had, if I understood correctly, decided and through a group of people decided that the only way that green was going to work is if it became culturally desirable, sexy. And as much as you might say now that green is a little diluted, it certainly is far more in our cultural vocabulary when every single, you know, company in the world has some product that has a green sort of angle to it. Do you consider that successful or a step in the right direction? He's basically stopped doing the Viridian List because he claimed that, you know, this idea that he had posited was successfully accomplished. And so that cultural desirability through marketing and presentation and consumer awareness is a very intriguing possibility. And I'm curious what your thoughts are on that.
Well, I am a big believer that we can reach people as consumers. And I always get into this argument with people, because people aren't consumers, they're citizens, you know, and you don't want to put them in a box. No one wants to be just someone who buys stuff. They want to be a person, and it's insulting to say that. And yet, Americans and more global citizens define themselves by the things they buy. And you can dislike it, you can hate it, you want to argue it, but people do. So, you know, I've noted before that people are more familiar and more intimate with their brand of toilet paper than they are with their member of Congress. There's just, it's just a, it, someone has a very visceral response. They know it. They're a Charmin person. And your toothpaste, right? It's like, your toothpaste. You probably know your brand of toothpaste. You definitely know them better than your you know, the local political struggles. Not you personally, but perhaps someone like you, most people. And that's, you know, that's, it's disturbing, but okay, let's move beyond that. Okay, if that's how people are plugged in, why don't we reach them where they're at? You know, if this is the basic organizing philosophy, is you start by reaching people where they are. You know, and then you can take them where you want them to go, or invite, trade, figure out a way to do that. So I start with that concept. I mean, something else, you know, we've been talking a bit about gender to start with. You know, one thing that was a surprise for me coming from a, you know, kind of progressive political position into a business world is that, you know, we always in the progressive political world try to use a she, you know, feminine terminology to show egalitarianism. In the business world, they use she technology, she terminology all the time because that's who shops. You know, 80% at least of shopping decisions are made by women, which, you know, you could disagree with me or not. I actually think women are better prepared to make some of these better consumer decisions. So that makes me kind of hopeful. Just a long way of answering the question that you asked. I guess I would just say that I don't think the work is done. I think that the greenwashing that we've seen has been problematic, but it's kind of going away. And now the challenge is to link all of these individual products that people are trying to buy and trying to get a hold of this into kind of a lifestyle, into a larger cultural movement, so that people don't have to badge themselves with things they buy. They can start badging themselves with music, with art, with the things they participate in, the friends they carry.
Well, I think too that less specific the green, but the cultural desirability of this alternative that we all need to come to if we're going to be able to have a sustainable planet. To make that, instead of a conversation about the things you're going to need to give up, but a conversation about how it's culturally desirable to be that person, to live that life on the planet, and how good that's going to be. I'd like to see a more, I guess, maybe a more positive conversation about that. I don't know if that will appeal to people more.
I think it will. You know, in the efforts of it to do that in the environmental movement are just, they're hard because they're it's like I don't know, it's the wrong salespeople for it, because you know, you don't go to politicians to ask you how you should be living your life. That's just not the cultural memes don't flow down from them. It's more likely that you'll connect to art for that, in my belief. Or actually, odd, you know, I think it's probably sad, but you know, or to marketing, to the way that you're marketed to. That's a you know, from the inside of that, I can tell you that's a very hard road to plow. It's one. So I'm interested, at least interested, in how we can create that desirability in other ways, not so literal ways, right? I mean, it's likely that the Sierra Club has a, you know, and Greenpeace, and you know, we have a buying guide somewhere that tells you how you should live, but the chance of you reading that and actually changing are zero, you know.
Mm-hmm. As long as we're on this, I'm kind of curious, especially since you're working within those sort of large corporations, the kind of thing that we've imbibed or established is that you can go green, but it's more expensive. Mm-hmm. And what? How do you reckon with that within those institutions that, or within those corporations that you work with? And how, you know, I think sometimes we feel like that we're being snookered around that, right? Mm-hmm. That's like it's not really true, or that, you know, it's a marketing ploy to get us to spend more money to buy organic or. Occurring at all within the places that you were?
You know, I try to fight that. I mean, I think that is the general concept, and that things that are green or more sustainable cost more. But of course, we have to break that down. I remember a kid, I used to, you know, try to get my dad to buy recycled paper, and be like, "Great, it's recycled. It's going to cost less, right? Because it's used paper."
Right.
It's like, no, it's going to cost a lot more. And, you know, that just doesn't make sense, right? It just doesn't make sense. For any of the companies I work with, they do not, there's none of them I ever worked with where they say, we have extra money, you know, we just want to spend this to look good. They you know, they'll probably spend some marketing dollars. That's sort of not the stuff that we do. It's all about saving money. Mm. And you know, one of the great things about working with you know, a company like Walmart is that there's no doubt in the world that that's the first reason to do it is because it saves money.
Right.
The second reason is because it builds an innovation culture. You start reinventing things when you think about things with fewer resources. But at this point, you know, Walmart has saved hundreds of millions of dollars by taking on green behaviors. Procter & Gamble, similarly, Coke. I mean, all the big companies are saving lots and lots of money by doing this. And, you know, large institutions as well, because it just makes sense in a lot of ways. The harder things are, you know, the more sort of vanity decisions, right?
Uh-huh.
So it's, you know, it's a material choice that may be organic, but it costs a lot more. And you know, those are hard choices.
Right. What in the readings that you gave us, there was this conversation in there about the accessibility. Since you were talking about the Desert Act, the accessibility of the deserts now to all kinds of people is ultimately going to destroy them. So like the thing that's great is what's going to destroy it, because so many people want to go. You know, I just finally got a chance to go to Yosemite in the spring last year, when to my mind it was packed, but everyone else said this is nothing compared to the summer. And so like, what's this experience like? So what is your thinking about that, and particularly in terms of the theoretical idea that he put forward in the argument? Where does that go?
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that Hardin establishes in the article, and I'll step back a second, that I'm going to assume that people had a chance to skim it or not at all. So that's okay. We're not in school in class. And actually, I brought a few extra copies if anyone in the audience is interested in reading it. The article is called "The Tragedy of the Commons." It was written by Professor Garrett Hardin in 1968, and this is the foundational or one of the foundational texts of the modern environmental movement. And you really can't go through an environmental studies degree program, or I think even in the high school AP environmental studies course, they teach this paper. So a lot of the mythologies behind environmentalism exist within this conversation. And what Hardin is posing first is this fable, this myth, which is a beautiful commons, a field, that's held collectively by a community. And one person, a herdsman, decides to put a cow on it, and everyone else does, and there's cows on this common, it's fine. The additional benefit of that one herdsman putting one additional cow on for him is, you know, additional dollar or $100. And the cost of him doing that is a small fraction of that, because it's, you know, it may take a little bit more of the common ground, the common land, but that's shared by everyone in the community. So there's basically nothing to stop that person from putting more and more cows on the commons until it is destroyed. And it's an apt metaphor for lots of ecological commons, from water, air, fish, and numbers of things that when we were on a wild planet with many more resources than we had people, that wasn't a problem, but now we have to reconsider. You know, for example, you know, 100 years ago, it was pretty common for people to eat, you know, wild meat as a part of their diet regularly. Today, that's pretty rare. You know, people in this room, if you eat fish, probably eat wild fish. That's just probably not going to be possible 20, 30 years from now, at least for most fish species. So, you know, wild tuna. Tuna is one, for example, one fish species that we've never really been able to figure out how to do through aquaculture, growing it, farming. So it's hard to imagine people eating tuna in the future, the way that we're fishing it now. So the metaphor is, what happens? How do we actually deal with it? And he proposes some solutions that I think are not particularly correct, but are the mental model that we start from. So we'll start with that as a
Great
opening.
Yeah, thanks. So then if you're not buying the solutions, or you're not you don't necessarily, so what are, what, how would you address the problem?
Well, okay, and this is the work that we're gonna do together today. We're gonna solve the tragedy of the commons.
Good.
No problem. Well, what I'd suggest is that, in some parts of it has been laws and legal ideas, et cetera. But if we can push this idea that, in the end, we do have lots of commons, some of them will be legislated, protected by that, in that context of legislation. But there are other ways to protect them as well. And, after the break, what we'll do is we'll break into groups and begin to identify a common and how we might protect it. Set up a piece of activism among ourselves to actually think about what we might protect. And I want to encourage you not necessarily to think about ecological commons, because that really, I'm much more interested in the process of protecting them than what we're actually protecting.
Right.